Welcome back, mineralogy fans. We covered most of the native element minerals that we are going to look at in the precious metals, but in this, our very last episode on basic mineral identification, we examine what comes of sulfur and carbon, the 13th and 15th most common elements in the Earth's crust, respectively. Sulfur has an earthy, resinous to vitreous luster, and here color is key, as few other minerals are as bright yellow as sulfur. Crystalline sulfur has a hardness of 1.5 to 2, so it's easily scratched like gypsum, and it's even sectile. It is a little less dense than most minerals at 2.05 to 2.1, so bright yellow, low density, and soft easily identify sulfur. It is clearly a reactive element, as we use it in gunpowder, fireworks, and matches. The name sulfur probably comes from a Latin root meaning to burn. It also has associations with hell and hellfire, as it is the brimstone around volcanic fumaroles. Mining from such environments often shortens miners' life expectancies down to a handful of years of working in the mines. These miners sacrifice themselves for their families and to supply us with the sulfur, which can clearly have some biological issues, so it is also used in fungicides, insecticides, and fumigants. I remember as a kid in Texas putting sulfur on my ankles to keep the biting arthropods known as chiggers from crawling from the ground and the grass onto our legs and biting us. And yet, poison is in the dose, and so we can ingest low amounts in products like sodas, and before you freak out, we've been eating sulfur for our entire history, as sulfur is the sixth most common element in biological organisms that make up our food. And us. We also use it in sulfa drugs and to treat some skin conditions. Vulcanizing rubber, making phosphate fertilizers, making sulfuric acid, and a zoo of other compounds we use every day. Take Epsom salts, for example. Bleaching agents and various chemical reactants use sulfur to do their job. We end this tour of native elements and thus the seven mineral groups with the carbon polymorphs of diamond and graphite. It's hard to misidentify diamond with its vitreous adamantine luster and hardness of 10, which we noted before is a very distinctive winner on the absolute scale of hardness. The hardness can be used to scratch quartz, topaz, and even corundum, but that might be a risky test, as diamonds are also very brittle, meaning they break easily. Maybe just note the specific gravity of 3.5 to start, and then test that amazing refractive index which gives diamonds their brilliance. The color can be all over, as can the clarity, which influences the value, such that an ounce of diamond can range from about, right at this time, $200 per ounce to around $300 million per ounce. That high end blows even the most expensive precious metals out of the water by over three orders of magnitude. The cheaper diamonds are mainly used as the ultimate abrasives for cutting, polishing, drilling, and grinding, usually by embedding the diamond bits into the saw, drill, bit, or grinding wheel. Diamond membranes are used as windows in X-ray machines and vacuum chambers, being strong enough to endure the rigors of both. Diamonds have the highest heat conductance of any material, and so can be used as a heat sink to adjust the heat imbalance in high-performance microelectronics. Coating surfaces with a diamond membrane will increase their durability and strength. Diamonds are even used as micro-bearings, where such low-friction bearings need to be very resistant to wear. But on the more expensive end, and more famously, diamonds are the premier gemstones for jewelry. The last native element mineral is a polymorph of diamond, meaning the same chemical formula, which is just C, carbon, but a different crystal pattern. Diamond has covalent bonds in all directions, whereas graphite has covalent bonds in sheets, which are loosely bound together. What a difference a crystal pattern can make! From an adamantine mineral with a hardness of 10, carbon can also make graphite. A silvery submetallic luster mineral with a hardness of 1.5 to 2, getting almost as low as talc. We said talc felt like soap, and you might say that graphite feels like soap or as if it's greasy. Like sulfur or talc, graphite is sectile, and because it is so soft, you can even leave its diagnostic black streak on something like paper. Though sometimes confused with lead for its submetallic silvery gray appearance, a specific gravity of 11.3 for lead versus 2.5 for graphite should make this distinction easy, but it does mean its name used to have origins surrounding lead, but was officially switched to graphite in 1789 to clear up this confusion between it and lead and molybdenum. Only graphite, the writing stone, was soft enough to write on paper. The slippery, greasy feel is key to many of its industrial uses as a lubricant, especially in cold environments where oil gets too viscous. In the Middle Ages, a deposit of graphite was found in England and mined out and used to mark sheep. While Queen Elizabeth was getting fooled by pyrite, as previously mentioned in the sulfides, her metallurgists were also using graphite as a refractory mineral to smooth out the interior of cannonball molds to make a faster and farther flying weapon. It is used as a refractory mineral, especially in steel making, and is used in batteries due to a high melting point and ability to conduct electricity. The high melting point also makes it good for blast furnace facing, as a fire retardant, and as brake linings. The softness is due to the covalently bonded carbon sheets sliding past each other, but the sheets themselves, known as graphene, are the strongest material known. But being very difficult to extract from graphite, most material scientists are trying to make graphene in other ways. With a diagnostic softness and black streak, graphite is also used in pencil lead, which shows again the historical confusion of this mineral with lead. It's really pencil carbon graphite, and some clay. And its use as such in writing and drawing has been over many millennia of human history, so it may seem I'm ending the mineral groups with more of a whimper than a bang with graphite compared to the preceding precious minerals and diamonds, but I guess it depends on how you value things in this life we're given. In our following episode, we take the next step up in our mastery of geology as we encounter the rocks that make up our world.